Watch now how to escape poverty and get rich in 2024 with multiple sources of income. If you watch this video until the end, you'll probably be the first wealthy person in your family because I'm going to teach you very important things. Let me ask you a question. Do you want to be successful in life? You can learn to be successful just as you learn math, chemistry, or biology. In the same way you learn these things, you can also learn to be successful, which is totally different from succeeding. Being successful is one thing, succeeding is another. For example, there might be a soccer player who has a lot of success playing soccer, but if you look at his personal life, it's all in a mess. This person is successful in playing soccer, but not successful in life. To be successful in life, you have to work in various areas, in the personal, professional, financial, family, social, and friendship areas. This is the big difference between success and being successful. What are you looking for? Do you want success in something specific, or do you want to be successful overall? Leave your comment. I already want to mention that if you want to be successful, watch this video until the end, because at the end of this video, you will find very valuable tips. Let's go back to our analysis. Now you might be thinking, to be successful, I would have to be born with a silver spoon. No, on the contrary. Successful people in life in general had difficult childhoods. 85% of people who consider themselves successful in Brazil came from humble families. That is, they worked as employees for someone, went through difficult times. So you are not doomed to be who you always were. Your past is gone and you can't change that. But your future is not yet written. You can start writing it today. If you can understand this, it will make a huge difference in your life, simply because you understand this perspective of tomorrow. Know that we are the only animals on planet Earth with the ability to transcend. That means starting over. It doesn't matter where you were born. It doesn't matter the upbringing you had in childhood. It doesn't matter what you did or didn't do until today. Tomorrow you can open a new book, start the first page. That's called transcending. But to do that, we have to make some changes first. You, me, everybody knows what I'm talking about. A series of beliefs. And our modus operandi is based on our beliefs. And these beliefs are often unfavorable. They are not bringing us the desirable results. A belief becomes obsolete when it is not giving us what we want, which is to evolve. So let's eliminate the obsolete beliefs that are not bringing us the desirable results. We don't need to reinvent the wheel. The secret here is to make it spin faster. Because someone has come before, studied all of this, researched millionaires, successful people, not only in terms of money, but in terms of family, health, etc. And they managed to identify what common habits these so-called successful people have. So, do you want to move towards success? I want to know where you are coming from. If you don't have a clear idea of where you are coming from, it is practically impossible to achieve the success you are seeking. So the first thing we need to know is your level of self-esteem. So I'm going to do a questionnaire here, very yes, very no. We will take five areas of your life: health, family, finances, professional life, and friendships. And for each of these specifically, you will give a rating from 1 to 10. Then we will add up these ratings, and then you will see what happens. Let's start first with health. We know people who are 30 and never get sick, right? And also, you must know people who are sick every day, so you will have to evaluate your health. If you are the type of person who never gets sick, is always well, you will give a rating of 10 because you are completely healthy. If you are a person who is sick every day, you will give a rating of 1. So, you have between 1 and 10, you will have to choose the rating that you think you deserve from 1 to 10. And then, how much would you give for your health? If you are a person who has a vice and smokes, drinks, and uses illicit drugs, of course, that will lower the rating. You have to ask your subconscious and determine what rating you have for your health. Now let's go to your family. When I say family, it's the family nucleus, my parents, children, siblings, in-laws, your family as a whole. From 1 to 10, what rating would you give? Do you have an ideal, perfect family with nothing to change? Then it's 10. Look, you first gave the rating for your health. Now you give the rating for your family. Now let's go to your financial life. How is your bank account? If you lost your job today, if you stopped working today, if something unexpected happened to you right now, how long will your current lifestyle last? This has a name. It's called an emergency fund. It's the number of days you can maintain your standard of living if you interrupt your income. If you stop working today, have you earned enough for money to work for you? Because money is an excellent employee, but a terrible boss. If you work for money, my condolences. But if, on the other hand, you put money to work for you, all right, that's what money knows how to do well, work for you. So how is your financial life? Are you the kind of person who can stop working for a while? Let's say you decide to stop working today, and what you have in savings or investments, will it yield enough to maintain your standard of living? What rating do you deserve? If you are in debt, spending more than you earn, or if you earn and spend everything immediately. You are earning and spending, you will give a rating close to 1. It's not me, it's you who will choose this rating, just like you chose the rating for your health, for your family. Now you are choosing for your financial life. But now let's go to your work, your professional life. Let me ask you a very simple question. If you won $1 million in the lottery tomorrow, the day after tomorrow, would you continue doing the same professionally that you do now? Or would you change? If you win $1 million tomorrow and the day after tomorrow, you are doing exactly the same. It means you are in total harmony with your professional activity, so there you deserve a 10. Now, if you are counting the days until retirement, it means you are not satisfied with what you are doing, then you deserve to receive a rating close to 1 or 2. We saw our health, we have the rating for family, we gave our rating for finance, we gave our rating for work. I have one more rating, which is friendship. I'm not talking about acquaintances, I'm talking about friends you can count on. Who can you count on today? Who do you know will help you? If you died today, who would come to your funeral tomorrow? Without a doubt, that's a good question to see who's close to you. So friendship, you have 2 things. First, it's the number of friends, and second is the quality of those friendships. Sometimes, it's much more important to have fewer friends, but of better quality. So, what's the rating? Well, now you've already given a rating for your health, for your family, for your finances, for your professional life, and for your friendship. Please add up these 5 ratings. Now I'm going to use an example here to help you. Let's suppose I gave a 7 rating to all these 5 areas of my life. I added 7 5 times, so the result is 35. I take this number and multiply it by 2, now I have 70. This means that I am operating at a self-esteem potential of 70%. Do it there, let's see what happens. Take these 5 ratings, add them up, multiply by 2, now you know where you're coming from. So, let's suppose if I'm coming from 70%, it means I'm using 70% of my self-esteem, 70% of the potential of my soul. If I now take this potential and increase it to 72, 73, this makes an absurd difference in the result. A small difference in performance brings a tremendous difference in the result. An example of this is a horse that comes in first. Compared to a horse that comes in second, the difference is a nose. That's just a small difference. The nose of the first horse crossed the finish line a little before the nose of the second. But think about it. The first will be remembered forever and will win the prize and be greatly praised. And the second, it's just a difference of a nose. No one will remember who came in second. That's because it was a difference of a few centimeters, fractions of a second. So learn that a small difference in performance brings a tremendous difference in results. You compare a poor, unsuccessful individual and a millionaire, successful individual. They get up more or less at the same time. They go to bed more or less at the same time. So you see that there isn't much difference between one and the other. But what is one doing? They are small details done constantly, strategically, that makes all the difference. Then you find out that you are operating at 60% of your self-esteem. Then you ask me, Dr. Eden, how do I improve? Then comes a crucial point. I will show you three things you have to do. The first thing is for you to develop a capacity for visualization, not of what you don't want, but of what you want. If you focus on what you don't want, instead of focusing on what you want, it's as if you were driving a car, looking through the rearview mirror. You know where you're coming from, but you don't know where you're going. So Einstein said that imagination is more important than knowledge. Every time there was a dispute between knowledge and imagination, imagination always won. So you have to learn to imagine the situation you want. It has to exist first in your brain. Let me give you an example. You dream of acquiring a new house. You have to see how many rooms it will have, how it will be built, what color the outer wall will be, what color the inner wall will be, how many bedrooms, how many bathrooms, what furniture, what carpet you will put. You start creating this new house in your mind. The more specific, the more characteristics, the more details you put. It will also be easier to create because everything that exists in the physical universe was created twice. You want to see it, look around you, choose any object that you saw there, anyone. It can even be the object you're holding right now. Yes, your phone. Even before it was created, it went through someone's mind. So everything that exists in the physical universe first existed in someone's mind before manifesting in the physical universe. So you have to learn the process of visualization. It's very simple. It's you closing your eyes and focusing on what you want. In your health area, in your family area, in your professional areas, in the most important areas of your life, you have to learn to visualize. That's the first thing you need to do, but it doesn't stop there. Have you noticed that since I started talking inside your head, there's a dialogue? An inner dialogue that is talking to you all the time. With many things you agree, but there are some things you disagree with. There's a conversation inside your head. There's a voice inside your head asking, what voice is that? So stop for a moment and pay attention to it. Is it a friendly voice or not? Do you consider it a friend? Or is it someone who is criticizing you? It can be your own voice, it can be your father's voice, it can be your mother's voice, but there is an internal dialogue inside that makes a huge difference in your life. That's the internal dialogue. What kind of dialogue do you have? So, when a negative dialogue appears, you have to say, cancel, cancel, cancel. Let me tell you one more thing, the way you carry your body. What is your posture? Go to a mall in your city and spend some time observing people passing by. There will be people walking with their necks straight, looking at the horizon, right? And there will be people walking with their heads down, looking at the ground. If you're in a room and a king, a queen, a prince, a princess enters, even if you don't know they're a king, a queen, you'll see that the person who enters has majesty. What does it mean to have majesty? They walk with an upright posture. They learned since childhood, the butler taught them that they had to walk as if balancing a book on their head. When I stretch my body, imagining that there's a hook coming from the sky, pulling my head, my neck stretches, my shoulders relax. I connect with universal intelligence, that flow of intelligence there. And you know what happens? I improve my self-esteem. So, to improve my self-esteem, I have to know how to visualize. I have to know how to deal with internal dialogue. I have to cancel what is negative. This is a very serious problem. Have you ever stopped to think that all the time we are imagining things, whether positive or negative? If I say, think of an elephant, at this very moment, you are imagining an elephant. Now, if I tell you, don't think of a lion, even though I said not to think, you ended up thinking. Do you know why this happened? Because the word no has no linguistic representation. For example, a mother will say, son, don't disturb your little sister. The mother is talking to the child, and he continues to disturb his sister because, for the boy's subconscious mind, the mother is telling him to disturb his sister. The mother here is focusing on what she doesn't want. What this mother should do is focus on what she really wants, which in this case would be, instead of saying, son, stop disturbing your sister, she should try this. Son, could you leave your sister alone? So, you have to express what you want, not what you don't want. And this also works in internal dialogue. Learn to control this, and this video will have been very worthwhile for you. It will give you immense long-term benefits. If you understand what I mean, please comment, "I understood." Now I'm going to teach another very important lesson. We are judged in life by three things: your appearance, what you say, and how you say what you say. If someone asks you a question, how you respond makes all the difference. I can have two bricklayers laying bricks. I go to the first bricklayer and ask, "What do you do in life?" He: "I am a bricklayer. I put one brick on top of the other." And then I ask the second bricklayer, "What do you do in life?" "I am also a bricklayer," he will answer, and he will continue saying, "I am building the Maracana, which is the largest football stadium in the world, and it will stay here for posterity." Look how interesting. Both physically do the same thing, put one brick on top of the other, only one sees it as a job, and the other has a broader perspective. So this other one won't be a bricklayer for long. Soon he will own a construction company. Second, you are judged by your appearance. Do you want to play for Flamengo? Don't show up there in Fluminense's uniform. Do you want to join the army? Don't show up there in shorts and a tank top. So you have to be appropriately dressed for the occasion. I'm going to teach success, so I have to be well presented according to the situation, understand? So you can be watching however you want in shorts, it doesn't matter, it doesn't matter. But if I were giving this lecture in a church, for example, I couldn't be in shorts and flip-flops. I would be teaching about success, so I should be dressed in success uniform. Appearance is very important. You are judged by your appearance. You are judged by what you say. While you haven't said anything, no one knows if you're intelligent or not. But the moment you speak and speak nonsense, there's no way to go back. An arrow once launched does not return. When a spoken word is launched, it no longer belongs to you. It has been thrown into the world. So if you're not sure what you're going to say, it's better to stay silent. Most wise people are respected for speaking little. And it's not just what you say, it's how you say what you say. Two individuals can say the same thing, and the impact will be totally different. There's a phrase that goes like this: the singer is more important than the song. You're a fan of a great singer, right? I imagine he has a song that touches your heart. That same song sung by a singer you don't like wouldn't have the same impact on you. So, know what you're going to say, how you're going to say it, and at the right time, okay? Let me see another important piece of knowledge for you. I know, pay attention. Imagine you're going to bake a cake. This cake is not made with just flour, not just with butter, not just with eggs. Of course, butter is important. The egg is important. It's necessary, but it's not enough. The success cake we are learning has six ingredients. The first ingredient is self-esteem, the second is communication, and now comes goals, comes attitude, comes work, and comes ambition. When you put these six ingredients together with patience, persistence, which are the characteristics of the professional that the amateur doesn't have, the amateur wants everything yesterday, but nature doesn't work that way. Dawn only comes after the whole night has passed, and so on. You plant a seed, the next day it's not a plant. It continues to be a seed, starting its germination process, but it continues to be a seed. So I have to understand that I am on the right path, and it takes time for that to happen. Many people end up making mistakes in this. Often a person gives up before things happen. That's why patience and persistence are essential. I wanted to talk to you now about a goal. It is necessary to learn to turn a dream into a goal, and then we will learn to turn a goal into reality, right? How do I turn a dream into a goal? I turn a dream into a goal by setting a date. Anything you want someday will never happen. So you'll have a dusty book on your shelf at home you said you would read someday, but it's been 4 years since you bought it. It's there because there's no someday on the calendar, do you agree? To start happening, you need to have a date. You say, "One day we'll do this." There's no day on the calendar with that name, so it will never happen. Now you put a date. Oops, now it makes all the difference. You have to learn to put dates on your dreams. The moment you put a date on the dream, it ceases to be a dream and becomes a goal. And the universe begins to conspire in your favor. But then you turned the dream into a goal. but you need to turn it into reality. That's another story. You can't stop there. First, I want to tell you that the importance of the goal is not necessarily to achieve it, but to set you in motion, because who knows, something more important will happen along the way. Do you want to see? I'll prove it to you. Think about the three most important things that have happened in your life so far, since you can remember. What happened most importantly? Three events: your wedding, the birth of your child, or a promotion at your job. You pass the entrance exam, you graduate from college. There are many important things in your life, but you will notice that at least two or three were not planned. You didn't wake up one day and say, "Today I'm going to meet someone because I'm going to fall in love, because I'm going to marry them." It wasn't like that. You just went somewhere, fell in love, planned, and got married. And that job you have there, you got a job at a company. Did you wake up one day and say, "Today I'm going to become an employee at this company"? Did it happen like that? No, you saw an advertisement, someone invited you, went for an interview, handed in your resume, got approved, and one day that you never imagined, someone called you and said, "You start working tomorrow." Interesting. I have to have goals to put me in motion, but I have to have my mind prepared for better things, right? Then maybe other opportunities more important than the one you're focusing on will arise in your life. You have to have this flexibility. And this goal cannot be just one thing. There must be diversification. Don't put all your eggs in one basket. Someone comes and carries your basket, it's over, takes all your eggs. For example, do you only have the profession of being a mother, which is the noblest profession on planet Earth, being a mother, and you dedicate yourself entirely to being a mother? Look at the risk you're taking. If you are a mother, one day your children will grow up, they will leave. We raise children for the world. They don't stay with us, they go take care of their lives. And then what will you say? "Oh, but now I feel empty." It's the empty nest syndrome. It's the mother who dedicated her entire life to her children. The children grew up, went to take care of their lives, and the mother feels alone. So you have to have diversity, you have to have a financial goal, you have to have a professional goal, you have to have a social goal, you have to have a family goal, you have to have a health goal. What's the use of earning a lot and having a heart attack when you're 40? Is it worth it? I won't take anything to the grave. The coffin has no drawer, the coffin has no pocket. Why earn all this money and leave this life without enjoying it? So you have to have leisure goals. "I have to diversify my goals." This is very important. You set a goal and it has to be remembered. Don't remember it only on December 31st and think it's all sorted out. No, 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 you have to remember it every day. The Orientals take a doll called Daruma, I don't know if you know, and paint one eye of the doll, paint the right eye of the doll, and then there's still the left eye to paint, and they put that doll on the table. That doll represents a goal, buying a new house. So every time they look at that doll, they remember the goal. It serves as a reminder for it. There are several Darumas in the room, many with both eyes painted and some with only one eye painted, because the goal has to be remembered. For example, are you studying medicine just because it's your parents' dream? No, 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 it's all wrong. Tell your father to take the entrance exam. You have to pursue a goal that is yours, that you really desire, understand? If an Oriental said he would buy a new house, and when he buys it, he goes there and paints the other eye of the doll. If you enter an Oriental's house, you will see that there are several Darumas in the room, many with both eyes painted and some with one eye painted. In 1945, Hiroshima, Nagasaki, everything was destroyed. 40% of Japan destroyed. Today it is among the top 5 countries in the world. Do you know what happened? Can you guess? From 40% destroyed to among the top 5 countries in the world. Remember this philosophy called Kaizen, always improve, continuous improvement. When you say, "I don't want anything else in life," I say, then it's time for you to die, because you're here to learn. Or rather, when you die, when you transcend, when you change your cosmic address, and when you get there on the other side, they will ask you 3 questions. The first question is, what did you learn there? This is a school. We are learning. The second question is, how is your passage through planet Earth? Did you make a better place for those who will come after you? And lastly, and most importantly, they will ask you, did you cost more than you contributed, or did you contribute more than you cost? Or rather, I recommend to you, when you put your head on the pillow to sleep at night, ask yourself a question. Did I cost more than I contributed, or did I contribute more than I cost today? And this today keeps adding up, keeps adding up, keeps adding up, right? Before that, it is important for you to consider this. I want to make it clear to you that life is a sequence of hellos and goodbyes. To give the next hello, you have to say goodbye. The big hello of your life you won't remember. But you gave it when you arrived here on planet Earth. You came here crying, and everyone here to welcome you was smiling. I hope that when you die, when you transcend, when you change your cosmic address, it happens exactly the opposite, that you leave smiling because you fulfilled your mission. And whoever stays here will be crying because you are leaving. And you have to learn to work with these six ingredients: self-esteem, communication, goals, work, attitude, ambition. And as I said, what distinguishes the professional from the amateur is patience and persistence. I don't need to worry about my weaknesses. I need to focus on my strengths. These strengths will make my weaknesses disappear. That's the big catch. So if you're not prepared, it's no use. If I offer you 20,000 euros a month to teach German in Germany, and you don't speak German, it's useless. So when you are prepared, and the opportunity appears, because it will appear, and most of the time, it comes in the form of a problem. So when it appears and you are prepared, people call it luck. Luck is nothing more than the opportunity arriving and you being prepared to seize it. In other words, your luck is built by you. That person adrift waiting for something to happen, nothing will happen at all. That's the big problem. Be prepared when the great opportunity comes. Watch now. The secret that Robert Kiyosaki used in the past and still uses today to get richer and richer. How to get rich quickly. This is one of the most searched queries on YouTube. You've probably looked it up at some point in your life, but the majority of people who want to be rich never really learn it. That's because they are always looking at the wrong side of the equation. But today, I will teach you to look at the right side. I ask you, do you really want to know how to get rich quickly? You'll need to seek external information because you won't learn this in school. Go ahead and comment, "I will be rich in 2024. So, let's begin. Have you heard the fascinating success story of Robert Kiyosaki? He came from a middle-class family and wanted to learn how to be rich since he was 9 years old. Robert is the author of one of the most well-known books worldwide on the subject of money. I strongly recommend that you read this book or at least listen to the audio version. You can easily find it on YouTube. In this video, you'll learn how to get rich the same way Robert Kiyosaki did. Today, he's the one who will teach you. Here's what he said. My father was the head of education, a PhD, a very important man, don't you think? I went home and asked, why don't we learn about money in school? He looked at me and said, because the government doesn't want to teach us that subject. The government tells us what we can and cannot teach. That sounded strange to me, and I said, wait a minute, don't we go to school to learn about money? He said, no, your job is to get a job. So I said, oh, but we get a job to earn money. And he replied, no, 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 the purpose of working is not to earn money. I asked, well, why don't we learn about money then, and skip the work part? He turned frustrated and said, if you want to learn about money, why not ask your best friend's father about money? It was about Mike's father. So I asked, but why Mike's father? He replied, because Mike's father is an entrepreneur. I asked, and what do you do? So I asked, and he replied, I am an employee, a government employee. And I questioned, what's the difference? He said, the difference is that the entrepreneur has to know about money, or else he won't be an entrepreneur anymore. And the employee doesn't have to know anything about money, because the government and the company will take care of him. I was still a child, so I was a bit confused. Then I just followed his advice, went to Mike's father's office, knocked on the door and said, I'm here, I'm 9 years old, and I want to know about money. He just turned and said, go away. That's how the rich dad, poor dad story began. And so after persisting so much, my rich dad finally agreed to teach me about money on the condition that he would never pay me, because the moment he paid me, I would think like an employee. And that's the trap. Undertake to be free, and that in my later years messed with my mind. He said, never want a paycheck, my son, understood. Okay, understood. He turned and said, how do I make money? I replied, by entrepreneuring, of course. So how do I learn to make money? First, he showed me the Monopoly board game. Then I started working for him. My rich dad had hotels, and I did tasks for him, like cleaning the floor, moving tools from one place to another, small things. And when I got older, I started working in the office, in marketing, not accounting. I was basically an apprentice, but always working for free. Then the way he taught me about money was by playing the Monopoly board game. Until one day, I got fed up. I turned and said, when are you going to teach me about money? So he replied, what do you think we're doing? I said, playing Monopoly. And he said, no, 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 it's more than that. We're teaching you about money. For example, you're learning how to buy and rent properties, buy and sell, buy cheap and sell for a higher price. That's one of the most lucrative formulas for making money. There are many formulas for success with money, thousands of them, but one of the best is playing Monopoly, buying cheap and selling high. So I asked what that means. He said, one of the best ways to acquire great wealth is to play Monopoly in real life. And he asked, what do you think I'm doing here? So I replied, I don't know. Then he took me outside and showed me his house and his hotels. 10 years had passed. I was 19 and in school in New York. That's when I returned to Hawaii. My rich dad had already bought a piece of land larger than half of Waikiki Beach. And even today, when you go to Waikiki Beach, what do you see there? The Hyatt Regency Hotel, that hotel is his. Just like in the Monopoly game, just as he did in the game, he acquired larger assets in real life. He only kept them because at that time, the property wasn't that large. So he had to buy all the smaller businesses because Waikiki was a small village. Then he went there, bought one business, then bought another. It took some time, but eventually he assembled this piece of property and then built the Hyatt Hotel, which is now a giant hotel, and he later sold it for $800 million. So that's how I learned about money. But of course I had some financial troubles for a good part of my life. There were people who stabbed me in the back, but that was good because it made me grow. That's the spirit of it. Yes, people who are afraid of making mistakes, as they teach in school, never grow, because in the spiritual world, where there is good and evil, right and wrong, high and low, and people just want to be right, be positive, and in reality it's not always like that. I wasn't from a very poor family by the standards of the time, but I was from a family that had a poor attitude. Let me explain. Poverty starts with a fundamental attitude. Poverty is a business that is transmitted, taught in families. And for people who are sitting at home right now with financial problems because they earn little in their jobs or even earn a lot but are doing what they don't like, maybe they learned this way, maybe common sense taught them, work hard to get something, or the rich are not good people. These things. The school system doesn't want to teach you about money because it's designed to teach you to be an employee, which is important. We need doctors, lawyers, specialists, but they don't teach about money. Most people lack real knowledge about business, such as accounting, debts, or taxes. You have to know about these things. But in school, no one teaches them. So when people ask me how my rich dad learned this, and his poor dad, who was educated, did not, the answer is very simple. It's because my rich dad's father died when he was 13, and then he found himself at 13 having to run the family business. And for that, he had to leave school. So it was a blessing. Sometimes blessings come in a form that initially seems very bad, but later it becomes a blessing. And soon, his teachers became his treasurer, his accountant, his lawyer, his banker, his real estate agents. So he had what I call real teachers, not fake school teachers. Most teachers in school don't follow ethics. They teach subjects that they don't actually practice. Once I asked a teacher, "Teacher, I'm in my third year of calculus, and this stuff about material strength, will I ever use it in life?" He turned and said, "No." And I said, Then why do you teach it? And he said, because I get paid for it. But have you ever used it? No. So, if I can give advice to people, I want to say seek real teachers, not fake teachers. A fake teacher is one who doesn't do what he teaches, and a real teacher does what he teaches every day. Accountants, my lawyers, are doing it every day. That's how I learn from them, solving the problems of my businesses. So I have accountants, lawyers, bankers. They earn little, I know, but they are necessary because they help me solve the problems that arise in my company. And the rich constantly say, don't tell them this. Don't tell people how they can be rich. Keep them poor. I myself am not religious, but the Bible says, you will always have the poor with you. And this is a harsh reality. Every poverty begins to emerge in the mindset first, and once it takes root, it affects your entire life. You are constantly affirming negative things about yourself. Okay, I'm not very religious, but when a person says, I can't, I won't be able, they sink and end up becoming what they said. My poor dad said that constantly, and my rich dad said, that's why he's poor. A poor person says, how am I going to buy this? I'll never be able to afford it, because deep down it's an escape, you understand? It's easier to say that. And do you know what my rich dad used to say? Instead of, I don't have money for that, how can I afford it? How can I do what is necessary to get there? He said, a question opens the mind and an affirmation closes the mind. See, when you say, I can't afford that, your mind closes and what you said ends up happening. But when you say, how can I afford that, your mind opens and you find countless solutions to solve your problem. For example, basketball and football. Both have teams, but with different rules. Other people are golfers playing alone. Each plays in their own way. And in the financial game, I follow the rules of real estate. So what I say to young people is, find your game and play it. Watch now, 10 important things you need to do in 2024 to become very rich. Throughout this content, I will present a careful selection of 10 areas that will not only boost your economic stability, but also open doors to achieving financial freedom. What areas have you been investing in? Currently, do the areas in which you invest bring prosperity? Do you dream of financial freedom? Be prepared to absorb not only the best advice, but also to reflect on how to apply them practically in your financial life. Remember that the journey towards financial freedom is a continuous build, and these tips represent a valuable guide to initiate and maintain this transformative process. Leave your comment as follows. I will be rich. Just comment this. I will be rich. When I see this comment, I will give it a little heart. Stay until the end, as investment 5 and 10 are the most important. Number 1. Stocks. Investing in stocks is a widely adopted financial strategy by investors seeking the coveted financial freedom. Stocks, representing a fraction of ownership in a company, are tradable instruments in financial markets, providing a unique dynamic of capital growth and passive gains in the form of dividends. It is essential to highlight that the stock market is dynamic, influenced by various factors, including economic, political, and global events. Continuous analysis and updates on market conditions are crucial for making informed decisions. Number 2. Fixed income securities. The investment category called fixed income includes different types of financial instruments, such as certificates of deposit, treasury bonds, and corporate bonds. These investments offer predictable returns, usually in the form of interest or regular payments, making them an attractive choice for those aiming for financial independence. The stability and predictability of these investments not only protect the invested money, but also provide a regular source of passive income. The allure of these financial instruments lies not only in stability, but also in the ability to reduce risks related to market instability while preserving the invested capital. Fixed income investments play a crucial role in building balanced financial portfolios. Additionally, the consistent generation of passive income through interest and regular payments is a valuable tool for those wanting to build a solid foundation for financial freedom. Number 3, investment funds. Exchange-traded funds, known as ETFs, are a form of investment that gives investors ownership of a diversified collection of financial assets, such as stocks, bonds, and commodities. This is an efficient way to make a portfolio more diversified, tracking the performance of an index or a specific segment of the financial market. ETFs are useful for those wanting to build a balanced portfolio, allowing easy access to a variety of assets in a single transaction. This not only aids in diversification, but also reduces investment risks. ETFs are a versatile and affordable form of investment, offering an efficient way to diversify portfolios, align strategies with market trends, and provide flexibility while maintaining high standards of transparency and operational efficiency. Number 4, real estate. Real estate investments are a robust way to invest money. This includes buying different types of properties, such as houses, apartments, land, and commercial buildings. The main goal of these investments is not only to earn money from rent, but also to see the value of properties increase over time, providing a broader financial return. Diversifying the types of properties you own gives investors the chance to have more options to earn money. Moreover, it can help build financial freedom. Investing in real estate is not just about making money from rent, but can also be a way to make your wealth grow. If investors approach this strategically, diversely, and flexibly, they can increase their profits and create a solid foundation for achieving financial freedom. Number 5, cryptocurrencies. Digital currencies, cryptocurrencies are an interesting type of online money not controlled by a single authority. They use a technology called blockchain to be secure and transparent in creating, storing, and transferring value. These currencies are becoming popular as an investment because they have the potential to increase in value and do not depend on traditional financial systems. This has caught the attention of investors and enthusiasts, offering a positive outlook for the economic landscape. However, if you want to pursue financial independence using cryptocurrencies, it is important to conduct careful research on projects, understand how the market works, and apply good risk management practices. Investing consciously, considering both opportunities and risks, is crucial to achieving the goal of financial independence in the world of cryptocurrencies. If you are watching up to this point, it is because you are interested in financial freedom. If you realize that you need to invest in any of these areas, leave a like and write which area interested you the most in the comments below. If you want to stay informed about all economic freedom topics, subscribe to the channel so you don't miss any content. Number 6, royalties. Royalties are payments that people receive when others use their creations, ideas, patents, or intellectual property. These financial compensations are important to encourage innovation and protect the value of unique things. Royalties are not just a one-time payment, but also a source of continuous income over time. This is essential for financial stability, acting as a kind of economic safety net. Thus, royalties are not just financial transactions, but investments that continue to generate money over time. Furthermore, royalties are not limited to a specific sector. They are used in various industries, such as arts, entertainment, and technological innovation. This makes them a versatile strategy for individuals and companies looking to make the most of their ideas in different situations. Number 7, specific skill. Acquiring a specific skill means becoming very good at something such as programming, graphic design, or digital marketing. This not only opens doors to jobs, but also helps earn money. Improving these skills not only offers professional opportunities, but is also a good way to achieve financial freedom. People who are experts in something often get higher salaries, can work for themselves, or even start their own businesses. Having specialized skills is not only good for finding jobs. Well-trained individuals can use their skills in different situations and industries. This not only makes them very good at what they do, but also creates a solid foundation for long-term financial security. Number 8, own business. Starting and managing your own business encompasses all stages, from the initial idea to the efficient administration and operation of the company, be it small, a startup, or even an individual venture. Having your own business not only offers professional independence, but is also a unique way to express personal passions and interests. In the world of entrepreneurship, people not only deal with the daily activities of their companies, but also play an active role in determining their financial success. By having direct control over business operations and strategies, owners can customize their approaches to meet not only market demands, but also achieve specific financial goals. This direct control not only provides a sense of empowerment, but also offers the opportunity to explore non-traditional markets. Associated with this autonomy is the opportunity to seek innovations and creative solutions standing out in the market. The ability to pursue personal passions in the business environment not only increases internal motivation, but can also result in products or services that meet the specific needs of the target audience. This combination of passion and profit can be a powerful boost to achieve not only financial success, but also personal knowledge and satisfaction. Number 9, healthy habits. Adopting healthy habits means doing good things for the body and mind, such as eating well, exercising regularly, managing stress, and ensuring good sleep. These practices not only benefit physical health, but are also important for maintaining mental health. Even though these habits are not typically considered in terms of money, it is crucial to understand that they have a significant impact on the pursuit of financial stability. It is important to realize that healthy habits not only affect personal health, but also have significant financial consequences. By adopting a healthy lifestyle, expenses on medical care decrease significantly. This happens because we avoid expenses on medical treatments that can be prevented by healthy habits. Moreover, it is fundamental to understand that healthy habits also provide a competitive advantage in your daily activities, which puts you at an advantage in the job market. The extra energy from a healthy lifestyle not only strengthens the body, but also improves the ability to seize career opportunities, leading to an overall increase in earnings over time. Number 10, right people. Having the right people in your network is crucial to achieving financial success and gaining independence. Developing solid relationships with mentors, colleagues, and experienced individuals not only provides valuable information, but also essential guidance for personal and professional growth. These connections can result in learning opportunities, strategic partnerships, and open doors for new ventures and investments. This significantly accelerates progress towards desired financial goals. Connecting with financially successful people, whether online or in person, adds an extra layer of inspiration and motivation to your path. Being in touch with people who have achieved the success you seek not only offers examples of achievements, but also helps strengthen and expand your own financial ambitions. This networking not only sets more ambitious goals, but also provides valuable support for creating strategic plans that drive your financial growth more effectively. Furthermore, diversifying your network beyond the financial field can further enrich your perspectives. By interacting with professionals from different sectors, you gain varied knowledge that is advantageous in investment decisions and business strategies. This comprehensive approach not only broadens your options for continuous learning, but also creates an environment conducive to identifying innovative opportunities and developing creative solutions to financial challenges. Watch now. How to get out of the rat race once and for all. Are you living intentionally or just existing on autopilot, focused on paying bills and invoices? Do you consider yourself financially free? Since our birth, we are thrust into a tiresome competition, an incessant cycle of hard work, material possessions accumulation, insufficient resources due to the consumption of these goods, followed by new efforts to preserve these scarce material resources. Thus, we encounter this routine day after day, resembling a trained dog chasing a ball or a rodent running endlessly inside a wheel without making progress. If you've never delved into finance or financial education, you are at serious risk of remaining your entire existence trapped in this cycle known as the notorious rat race. The purpose of this video is to alert you and help you escape the most common phenomenon in society known as the rat race. Give it a thumbs up if you answered yes to any of the initial questions, and subscribe to the channel if you're willing to achieve a future of great financial prosperity. Write, "I will exit the rat race," in the comments here so you can affirm this statement confidently. Stay until the end of the video if you want to know the most important tip to break free from the vicious cycle of debt. The truth is, no one is sure who coined the term rat race. But we know it began to be used in 1929 during one of the most serious economic crises in history. This period persisted until around 1940, affecting nation after nation globally. At that time, humanity faced the worst challenges that a severe economic crisis and financial resource scarcity could generate in people's lives. For example, in the United States, the unemployment rate during the 1929 crisis reached 25%. This means that one in every four workers was unemployed. All workers who managed to keep their jobs experienced salary reductions, increased working hours, and alarming working conditions. Many workers lost their lives during working hours, and the statistics reached unprecedented levels. In addition to all these problems, job stability was non-existent, and thousands of people were laid off daily, with tens of thousands accepting to work more hours for lower pay. In this period of scarcity, unemployment, need, and cycles, workers began to mention this phenomenon as the rat race, a concept in which one works for money, pays bills, runs out of resources, works again, pays bills, runs out of money, always dependent on one thing, the job and the boss, consuming all energy at work without ever making progress. In 1969, the expression became popular with the release of Dr. Lawrence J. Peter's book titled The Peter Principle. In this work, the author addressed the term in the context of work and advancement within companies. However, the rodent race, as we know it today, gained worldwide fame in 1997 when Robert Kiyosaki published the book Rich Dad, Poor Dad. In this work, he details the competition and offers guidance on how to escape it. The reason people enter and remain trapped in the frantic competition lies in the relationship that financially uneducated individuals establish with work and money. For this group, money, instead of providing freedom, acts as a form of confinement, keeping them increasingly entrenched in the system. The term rat race refers to these lab mice that spend all their energy seeking illusory rewards, preventing them from progressing. Similarly, most people work hard, consuming their energy in the pursuit of money that will be used to acquire products, hoping to achieve small doses of happiness. The more financial resources a person acquires, the larger the financial obligations become, and the more they need to endure to keep the gears turning. In the book, Rich Dad, Poor Dad, the author instructs us that from childhood, we are guided to attend a higher education institution, enter the workforce, and perform roles to earn income, which will be allocated to living expenses, settling bills, and acquiring goods. It is clear that there is nothing wrong with acquiring knowledge, graduating, and engaging in professional activities. After all, for many starting out, this represents the only opportunity to gain financial gains. The difficulty lies in the fact that we are rarely guided on managing the financial resources obtained. Many know the art of striving to earn income, but are unaware of how to manage money. Thus, they spend their existence trapped in a cycle of working incessantly, earning more, spending more, and ending up without resources due to excessive spending. As a result, they restart this cycle to maintain their consumption pattern. This way of living with fictitious rewards leads people to pursue illusory satisfactions based solely on consumption and the accumulation of limited material goods. In the end, a lifelong work routine is created to sustain the scarce material goods achieved and acquire a few additional ones. In this context, two reasons lead people, even involuntarily, to enter this cycle: fear and greed. It all starts with fear, because the fear of not being able to provide for oneself and the family drives the search for money. Thus, people begin a hard and dedicated effort, motivated by the fear of not having enough to survive. Gradually, this effort results in a more concrete income, reducing fear and increasing greed. As income grows, the tendency is to consume more. The more money is earned, the more is spent. It's easy to fall into the trap of thinking that a financial increase solves all life's problems. However, the truth is that the more money one has, the more desires for consumption arise. Many justify their expenses by claiming they deserve rewards for their efforts. Unfortunately, this reward can prove detrimental. The increase in greed leads people to consume excessively without considering the consequences. Therefore, it is crucial to moderate our relationship with money and consumption, seeking a balance between what is necessary and extreme spending. It becomes evident that wealth cannot be the sole source of contentment and satisfaction in existence. Based on this, it can be stated that the issue lies not solely in the money one obtains, but in the adopted mindset. Regardless of the financial sum acquired, this dilemma will persist without a change in thinking. There are fundamentally three elements contributing to staying in the incessant race. The first element is having expenses beyond what one earns. Some people believe that upon receiving money, they must immediately spend it. However, certain individuals exceed this limit and begin to consume even before receiving money, incurring credit card debts and financing expensive assets such as a vehicle or a more luxurious residence. This behavior leads to bearing high interest rates, excessive costs, and often getting entangled in debts for the rest of their lives. The second element is acquiring goods recklessly. Those trapped in the incessant race share a characteristic. They often spend impulsively, anticipating desires and paying a high price for them, subjecting themselves to interest and values higher than the actual worth of things. On many occasions, after impulsive spending, they realize that if they had not acted on impulse, they could have acquired the same material good for a much lower price. The third element is a lack of knowledge about how to invest one's own money. In general, they are unaware of the possibility of investing, as they are constantly preoccupied with indulging themselves. While deserving quality things, this is not how they will achieve it. In fact, it would be wise to consider that the greatest reward they can give themselves is freedom. Now that you are aware of the elements that keep you trapped in this vicious cycle, you may be wondering how to escape it. The first step in breaking free from this race is what you are already doing: understanding the problem and acknowledging its existence. The second step involves the educational aspect. It is necessary to dedicate yourself to studies, reading, watching videos, and applying the acquired knowledge in your life. However, there are three crucial aspects that should not be forgotten if the intention is to avoid entering this constant competition. I will present these three suggestions from this moment on. The first suggestion is to establish a contingency fund that covers your costs for a minimum of 6 months. To calculate this amount, you need to multiply your monthly expenses by 6 and save that amount in an emergency fund. Having a safety net allows you to start your activities with more serenity and without fear of taking risks. This reserve is crucial so that you can invest in various income sources, thus freeing yourself from the incessant race. The second suggestion is to pay off all your debts and start making purchases only in cash. Although it is attractive to pay for a purchase in installments, debts can expose us to uncontrollable interest, causing you to spend much more than necessary. It is vital to remember that while you have not reached wealth, banks impose high interest rates, leading you to overdraft and applying revolving interest on the credit card. These charges can consume a significant portion of your financial resources and further complicate your economic situation. Keeping control over your credit card expenses is crucial. Avoid acquiring items you cannot afford, and always check the total amount of your bill. Otherwise, you may end up spending much more than you should and getting involved in a difficult-to-pay debt. The third suggestion, the most crucial of all, is to create new sources of income. Observing the most prosperous people in the world, it is noticed that all of them have more than six distinct sources of income. Do not rely solely on a single source of income as if it ceases. You are destined to work in insecurity. It is essential to study investments and entrepreneurship to access new ideas for income sources. Whenever you have the desire to spend your money on something as a reward, remember that the best reward you can offer yourself is financial freedom. Congratulations on making it this far. Don't forget to leave your like and comment. Which suggestion did you like the most? Follow these tips and soon you will find yourself free from this exhausting race. Now look for other videos on this channel that will provide you with deeper support on financial independence. See you in the next video.